James chapter 2. Let's start reading in the context, starting in chapter 1. I think I'll start with verse 21, just to kind of give us a context of what's going on. Wherefore, lay apart all filthiness and superfluity of naughtiness, and receive with meekness the engrafted word which is able to save your souls. But be ye doers of the word, and not hearers only, deceiving your own selves. For if any be a hearer of the word, and not a doer, he is like unto a man beholding his natural face in a glass. For he beholdeth himself, and goeth his way, and straightway forgetteth what manner of man he was. But whoso looketh into the perfect law of liberty, and continueth therein, he being not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the work, this man shall be blessed in his deed. If any man among you seem to be religious, and bridleth not his tongue, but deceiveth his own heart, this man's religion is vain. Pure religion and undefiled before God and the Father is this, to visit the fatherless and the widows in their affliction, and to keep himself unspotted from the world. Chapter 2. My brethren, have not the faith of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory, with respect of persons. For if there come unto your assembly a man with a gold ring in goodly apparel, and there come in also a poor man in vile raiment, and ye have respect to him that weareth the gay clothing, and say unto him, Sit thou here in a good place, and say to the poor, Stand thou there, or sit here under my footstool. Are ye not then partial in yourselves, and are become judges of evil thoughts? Hearken, my beloved brethren, hath not God chosen the poor of this world, rich in faith, and heirs of the kingdom which he hath promised to them that love him? But ye have despised the poor. Do not rich men oppress you and draw you before the judgment seats? Do not they blaspheme that worthy name by which ye are called? If ye fulfill the royal law according to the scripture, Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself, ye do well. But if ye have respect to persons, ye commit sin, and are convinced of the law as transgressors. For whosoever shall keep the whole law, and yet offend in one point, he is guilty of all. For he that said, Do not commit adultery, said also, Do not kill. Now if thou commit no adultery, yet if thou kill, thou art become a transgressor of the law. So speak ye, and do so, as they that shall be judged by the law of liberty. For he shall have judgment without mercy, that hath shown no mercy, and mercy rejoiceth against judgment. Lord Jesus, we ask that you give us understanding. Lord, apply this word to ourselves, to our lives, to the way we think, dear Lord. Let us be changed by your word, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. James says it like it is, and he puts rubber on the Word of God, where the rubber meets the road. He says it the way it really is. Not the way people want it to be. People want to look good in front of everybody. People are more willing to have other humans like them and respect them than God. We all know we're going to have to someday stand before God and answer for every thought, word, and deed. But that's so far in the distance. We just want everybody to think right now, it's just most important right now for people to like me and to think that I'm a good Christian and I'm a godly person and I'm doing the best I can and God is pleased with me. And God is blessing my life and God is blessing my ministry. We want people's approval more than we want men's approval. Well, the fear of man is a snare, Proverbs says. Which means, if your concern is the reputation and the awe and the respect of humans, it's a snare, it's a trap. It's ensnares you, which means you are now under its control, and you're not in control anymore. We see this a lot in Christianity, in Christendom, historically through the ages. It's always been this way. I mean, if you study church history is filled with stories of people buying church offices. You know, when it was the Holy Roman Empire, it was secular. It was a Christianized secular society. And basically, the Pope was the emperor of the Western world. He had more political power. And what he would do is he would, if somebody of political power who he basically anointed and put in its place didn't do what he said, he would put the pressure on. He would tell that prince's kingdom that I'm going to excommunicate your entire state unless you do what I say. Now everybody who is under the authority of that prince is going to say, oh, we're going to go to hell. And they're going to put all kinds of pressure and have uprising against their ruler. That's what they did. And it went on for hundreds of years. Well, finally it all disintegrated, you know, and secularization came into being, and they basically threw God out of the picture, and it all became about man's reason. And there was all kinds of revolution going on. In certain areas in Northern Europe, they stayed Christians because of the Reformation. They had God's word, and they were no longer under the authority of the Roman Catholic Church. And they followed God's principles. And they stayed their own independent nations for a long time. But the nations who had been Roman Catholic, when they completely rebelled against a system which had no spiritual power behind it, they became completely secular. And that's where, you know, there was all these beheadings and the French Revolution and all these ugly... I mean, this is the worst revolution. It started in the French Revolution and then it went on with Napoleon and went on with everything that went on with Lenin and Stalin and everything else. Totally secularized state, and it killed millions of people. Well, it wasn't a God-fearing government. It was still a government of man, and it was all based on the fear of man. Well, instead of people being afraid to go to hell, now they've just thrown God out of the picture, and now their fear of man is just an earthly secularized ruler. And that's what's happening to our country. We used to have more of a Christian country that had godly principles. We had more of a biblical worldview. And a lot of different things happened that caused us to stay with a biblical worldview for a long time. And one of those things is the Civil War. When the rest of the Christian church was coming under, you know, the liberal theology in England and already in Europe and then into England, we had a Civil War going on. So people were on their knees praying. It didn't happen until the early part of the 20th century when all that stuff came into the Christian church. And now there's biblical scholars who are teaching in seminaries, raising up pastors who aren't saved, and the pastors aren't saved, and they're pastoring congregations, and they're founding more and more theological institutions of people who aren't saved. There's problems. Then you have this huge Christian culture of people who aren't saved, who don't have a real relationship with God. The same thing that happened in the Holy Roman Empire, these people weren't saved. They didn't have their own real relationship with God. They thought they did. They did the rituals of the church thinking that's going to get them in. They weren't saved. So how can you tell a Christian from a non-Christian? And now in our own country, there's so much secularized Christianity, and you've got people who are selling millions of books who don't believe in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Well, that means they're not saved. They're not going to go to heaven. They don't have a real relationship with Jesus. Now what happens? Who's a Christian? Who isn't? Now why am I bringing that up? Because the same thing happened already in the beginning of the early Christian church. Now, in the book of James, in the first verse of the first chapter, he says, James, the servant of God and the Lord Jesus Christ, to the 12 tribes which are scattered abroad. He's talking to the Jewish Christians, the 12 tribes. He's not talking to the church, he's talking to the Jewish Christians. Why? Because the church first was a Jewish church. It took quite a few years, I mean maybe even 10 years, before God gave this vision to Peter, where, you know, there was this big sheet that came down filled with unclean animals, and Jesus said, "Get up, Peter, kill and eat." And he says, "I've never eaten anything unclean. And I've stayed kosher my whole life, and this happened 3 times. And at the same time, God had sent an angel to Cornelius to say, "Go get Peter, he's going to tell you the way to get saved." And when Peter followed them, the Holy Spirit came down upon the church, the brand new Gentile church, the same way the Holy Spirit had come down upon the Jewish church in Acts chapter 2, in Cornelius' house. Why am I saying that? Well, this is a very early book of the New Testament. And most of the Christians are Jewish. So is that a big deal? Well, the problem is that a whole lot of the Jews had not accepted Jesus as Messiah. Many had. And as they were accepting Jesus as Messiah, a lot of the families of these people were casting them out of their family. They were having a funeral service for their brethren who became Christians. They were acting as though they never lived. They were getting kicked out of the synagogue. This is the place where you went to church every Saturday. You come and you hear the word of God spoken, and then people have some exposition of the word, and then they're praying. Well, you can't even go anymore because you're a Christian. This is what's been happening. Well, now groups of people are getting together who are Christians, but most of the church at this time is still Jewish. It still applies to us, because everything that went on there, where you have a Jewish society who has basically got a biblical worldview, obviously it's Old Testament, we have a Christian society. Well, a lot of the Jews didn't have a biblical worldview, if you remember. There were some very strong Jews that love God's word. They were called the Pharisees. Now, Jesus had lots of problems with the Pharisees because they refused to see Jesus as Messiah. Because they saw all the prophecies of Messiah, but they neglected to look at Messiah's first coming, where he came as a suffering servant. All they could see is, here comes our national leader who's going to free us from all Roman occupation and any other kind of But why? Because there's a whole bunch of prophecies that weren't fulfilled yet as Jesus comes to rule and reign. To sit forever on the throne of his father David and rule from Jerusalem. It hasn't happened yet. Still hasn't happened yet. They were looking for this earthly ruler. Well, the Pharisees had, they had so many commentaries, so to speak, that they weren't following God's word. They were following what the commentators, their rabbis, had said about God's word. So in the laws that were dealing with God, they were very, very strict. And they had all these extra laws that were dealing with any law dealing with God. But the laws dealing with the fellow man, they had loopholes everywhere. Because they made sure that when it's dealing with a law between God and man, we're gonna be squeaky clean. And so they added extra laws to make it virtually impossible to break any of the laws that God had given. So they had all kinds of regulations for the Sabbath day. So all the time, Jesus was being accused by the Pharisees of him or his disciples breaking the Sabbath. Were they breaking the Sabbath? No. They were breaking the traditions of men that were being taught as the law of God. But they weren't ever breaking the Sabbath. Some of the commentaries will say, "Oh, well, Jesus broke the Sabbath." No, he never broke the Sabbath. And his disciples didn't break the Sabbath. But what did they break? They broke the Mishnah. They broke the Talmud. They broke all these rabbis' understanding of what the Sabbath should be, because they gained all these extra laws. And how many steps can you take and not break the Sabbath? How much work can you do and not break the Sabbath? So they had all these ways of looking at it to make it virtually impossible to break any law dealing with God. but there were laws dealing with their fellow men, that they had excuses not to obey. And Jesus would come face to face with the Pharisees all the time, dealing with those laws, because they were not giving mercy and taking care of people. They had all these loopholes while they didn't have to. He was saying, hey, how come you have your own law and you break God's law? You say, I'm not going to take care of my parents in their old age because everything I have given it to God. It's korban. So, sorry, Mom and Dad, I know you're hungry and you don't have anything to eat today, but all the stuff that I could have used from, you know, my business to help you, I really want God's blessings. I want to give glory to God instead. So all this money is going to God instead. So it's, you know, it's bequeathed to the temple. Well, they were still managing these funds, but they weren't taking care of their parents in their old age. I mean, Jesus was holding them accountable. Those are examples. But the laws dealing with God, boy, they were squeaky clean. Now, the Sadducees was another group. The Sadducees were the secularized Jews. These are like the modern theologians in all the modern churches that we've got today that don't take God's word seriously, that don't believe that the Bible is inspired by God. And so they didn't believe in the resurrection. They didn't believe in miracles. I mean, it's like Thomas Jefferson. You know, you can look online and see the Jefferson Bible. And he took a penknife and cut out every place that had a miracle. Even to the point that Jesus didn't even rise from the dead. He cut that out. Because it would be something that was, you know, supernatural. He didn't believe in the supernatural. He was a deist. He wasn't a Christian. Same as Benjamin Franklin was not a Christian. They didn't believe in the resurrection of Jesus. Doesn't matter if the Mormons baptize their name or not. They're not going to be in heaven if you don't believe in a resurrection. It's as simple as that. But you got people like Rob Bell today who, you know, Love Wins. Great book. Everybody goes to heaven. Everybody gets forgiven. All dogs go to heaven. If he really believes that, he's not going to be there. Not all dogs go to heaven. Sorry, it's not the way it works. There's a whole lot of bad dogs out there who don't submit to the Lordship of Jesus Christ. We have the same situation. There's lots of Sadducees who call themselves Christians to this day. And they have, you know, big, powerful churches. All the Ivy League schools were originally theological institutions. And they still publish. I mean, you can get stuff from Princeton, you can get stuff from Oxford, you can get stuff from Cambridge, you can get stuff from Harvard, you can get stuff from Yale, that are theological, amazing books of linguistics and history and all kinds of stuff. And ain't nobody saved over there. They don't even allow you to have a Bible study over there. They don't allow you to have prayer meetings over there in Jesus' name anymore. They're completely secularized. They've been secularized for years. They don't believe that the Bible is inspired by God. We have the same situation. But as the Jews had it with the Old Testament, we have it with the entire Bible. All these people would be offended if you said that they weren't a Christian. I mean, they're pastors of churches. Of course they're Christians. They're Christian churches. They'd be offended. But they're not going to go to heaven. Because they don't believe that they're sinners. A lot of them don't believe that evil exists. They don't believe that Jesus, God's Son, would die on the cross to die for their sins. They don't like that. They call it a slaughterhouse religion. Oh, God the Father is a child abuser by killing his son instead of us getting what we deserve? I mean, they have totally thrown away everything that the Bible says about the propitiation of Jesus Christ. They've thrown away what the Bible says about the blood of Jesus Christ cleansing us from every sin. They don't want the Bible telling them that they're sinners. They want to feel good about themselves. And if they're not a sinner, why in the world do they need to be redeemed? They believe in evolution, from the goo to the zoo to you. So if you're just an animal, you're just going to do what comes natural. You know, survival of the fittest. So if you're just an animal, why do you need to be redeemed? But if you were created in the image of God, created to give glory to your Creator, if you were made special, a completely different from everything else that God created, He created you so that you could have a relationship with your Creator. And then you rebelled against Him and broke every opportunity you possibly could have from knowing your Creator. And then your Creator came in human form. He became a man and lived the perfect life that you were incapable of living. And then He died on the cross to pay for all of your sins. And then He rose from the dead to prove that what He did on the cross was sufficient to take the wrath of God away from you. Now whoever believes in Him will not perish but have eternal life. That's what it means to be a Christian. Now I know there's a whole lot of information and it doesn't have anything to do with anything, it seems like. But it has everything to do with the context of where we are studying James. Because there is a Christian culture that says that the Bible is their guide that we have. No different than James. There was a Jewish culture, and now a bunch of these Jews were getting saved. They understood that Jesus was their Messiah. Now that Jewish culture was slowly becoming more and more what we would look at as the church, as more and more Gentiles were coming into the church. Now I'm saying all this because we're in the same situation. We can grow up in the church, and we just think we're Christians, so we're going to go to heaven. You know, we go to church. I pay my tithe. I worship God. You know, I have a Christian bumper sticker on my car. You know, I even got a little cross that I wear. I mean, what do you mean? No, it's a real relationship with God. It has nothing to do with ritual. It has nothing to do with what you call yourself. Has there been a permanent change? Are you born again or not? In the context of where we are in James chapter 2, he says, "But be ye doers of the word, not hearers only, deceiving your own selves." Well, a lot of the people who were going to church, they just assumed that they were the followers of Jesus the Messiah, that they were going to go to heaven. But their lives hadn't been changed. Now, they obviously grew up Jewish. They knew God's word. And now they realize Jesus is Messiah. And they followed Him. Now those people who believed on Jesus, they absolutely were saved. But a lot of people, they just kind of morphed into something new. It became an intellectual assent to becoming a Christian. And a lot of people in our Christian culture have the same thing. It seems to make sense. Okay, I'm a Christian now. But has there really been a conversion? Okay, the last two verses of chapter 1, James makes it really clear. If any man among you seem to be religious, and bridleth not his tongue, but deceiveth his own heart, this man's religion is vain. If somebody thinks they're a Christian, and they're doing their Christian service, and they're a worshiper of God, but he doesn't wash his mouth, he needs to have his mouth washed out with soap instead. He's deceived himself by opening up his mouth and letting what's really on the inside come out. And he says, doesn't matter how religious this guy thinks he is, it's useless. His religion hasn't done him any good at all. And then he says, pure religion and undefiled before God and the Father is this, to visit the fatherless and the widows in their affliction. Now visit doesn't mean, hey guys, how's it going? See you later, you know. Throw a sandwich under the door or something. No, this is to take care of God's people who don't have anybody to take care of them. That means a woman who no longer has a husband who is there supporting the family. And these are kids who no longer have parents to take care of them. It means taking care of them. It doesn't mean visit. Like, oh, how you go, you know, once a month we go and stop by the orphanage and say hi to the kids and cut their hair. No, this isn't that kind of visit. This is taking care of them. And to keep oneself unspotted from the world. Do we look more like the world or do we look like Christians? Well, what does a Christian look like? You know, in the town that I went to college in, we were the Lutherans on one side and then the Bible Baptists were on the other side. Well, the Lutherans just looked like the world. I mean, you know, we drank. We had a drinking school. It was sick. And it was, you know, because Luther had his own brewery, so, you know, Lutherans were really good at making sure that they, you know, used every one of their Christian liberties to the fullest extent. And there was a lot of my classmates, if they weren't already alcoholics, they were on their way there. So, very sad. But on the other side of town was the Bible Baptist, who was Maranatha. And these guys were Bible Baptists. I mean, they, you know, the girls, they always wore dresses and way below the knee. And, you know, the guys always had to have a suit. Or if they just had to have a shirt and had a tie, you'd think they were Mormons if they were walking around today. But they always had to dress nice. They always had to have their hair cut short. But what was weird is the girls, they had makeup and hairdos from the early 60s. And I don't know what that was, but it was very weird. I mean, they had clown-looking faces and they had the big bouffant hairdos. And it's like, wait a minute, this isn't... I mean, I went there late 70s, early 80s, but they still had... I guess it was more sanctified way of having, you know... It was weird. Anyway, all I have to say, they looked like Christians. Everybody knew they looked like Christians. So they were looking unspotted. But as soon as they could, you know, get in town and claim, you know, change their clothes, and they'd like be like a normal human being and get in trouble like everybody else. And they had lots of marriages that had to go on over there at that college. So they're just human beings, just like anybody else. Didn't matter how they were dressed. Didn't matter how good their theology was. But anyway, all that to say, they weren't any worse. We weren't any better. I don't know who was worse. We're all a bunch of kids. Didn't know what we were doing. But those of us who had Jesus as our Lord and Savior, we had what was important. Didn't matter how we dressed. We got a lot of mega churches now, and it's all about being edgy. You got the edgy pastor, and he's got the edgy cut of his beard, and the edgy cut of his mustache, and he's got the edgy hairdo, and he's got the funky, edgy clothes, and the halfway short sleeve, mid-sleeve, and a really edgy glasses, and you got the worship leader, and he's got the tattoos, and he's got the piercings, and, you know, he's got really stylistic worship, and you can barely follow him, but it's really good music, and he's a really great performer, and he's really edgy, and all the kids like it, and it's really loud. Are you worshiping the one true God? Whose authority are you under? Are you under the world's authority to do church? Or under the authority of the Lordship of Jesus Christ? Give me a break. No, James says, keep yourself unspotted from the world. Keep your church unspotted from the world. Keep the way you cut your beard unspotted from the world. Do you look more like Satan or more like Jesus with the beards that you wear? You know, I mean, give me a break. Anyway, I don't trim the sides. I keep them up like Jesus does. Yeah. Anyway, now we're supposed to be unspotted from the world. The way we talk, what we do, how we dress, the way we drive. I mean, the music we listen to, the words that come out of our mouths are supposed to be unspotted. We should look more and more like Jesus every day, and I don't mean long hair and wearing a robe and sandals, unless you know, live in Southern California or something. But no, to be unspotted, not to look like anything like the world, but to be more and more like someone who is pursuing holiness, someone who wants to live a godly day every day. Chapter 2, my brethren, have not the faith of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory, with respect to persons. So he says, here's another thing, to no longer look like the world. Don't act like the world. Don't have the attitudes that the world has. For if there come unto your assembly a man with a gold ring and goodly apparel, and there come in also a poor man of vile raiment, and ye have respect to him that weareth the gay clothing, and say unto him, sit thou here in a good place, and say to the poor, stand thou there, or sit there under my footstool, are ye not then partial in yourselves? And are ye become judges with evil thoughts? Well, this is what happens in church. Now, this isn't to criticize the Jewish church, but most of the Christians at that time were Jewish. And a lot of the synagogues got saved. And I have to say that because in verse 2 of chapter 2, For if there come unto your assembly, that word assembly is the word synagogue. So there were synagogues where Jesus was Messiah. Now, we don't think of that because when we're going through like the book of Acts and we hear about Paul's life, he starts off and he preaches the gospel in the synagogue first. Every new town he goes to, he starts at the synagogue because he's got a starting point. They've got the scriptures and he's going to go there as a rabbi and they're going to let him talk and he's going to show them through the scriptures that Jesus is Messiah. And he keeps talking until they kick him out. And he does it every time, but they're kicking him out more times than not. So we don't see a lot of Christian synagogues. But James is talking to people in a Christian synagogue. That's amazing. As it got more Greek and more Gentiles came into the church, it wasn't so easy. And a lot of things happened because there was more and more persecution that went out. If you remember, after Stephen was preaching, there was this persecution that came out. Now, he got stoned to death. And persecution went, and so it became more and more difficult. So now a lot of these synagogues that might have become completely converted to having Yeshua HaMashiach, they no longer could do that. So now people are having to meet someplace either secretly or someplace because they've been ostracized from every bit of God's family that they used to know. So he says, my brethren, that means, yes, my Jewish brothers and sisters, but he's also, my brethren means those people who he's connected to, that's fellow Christians. And so it applies to us. It applies to us. So, okay, your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory. You say you have faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory, the glorious one. Don't have your respect, don't have your faith in Jesus connected to your respect of persons. Now, the word respect of persons, we think of respect. And, oh yeah, we're supposed to respect everybody. You know, I respect people and then they respect me. Well, that's the idea. That's just an old English word. That's not what he's talking about. You know, we live pretty much in a classless society and nobody respects anybody. That's not what's going on. The idea is having preferences, certain people over other certain people. And having prejudices, certain people over other people. And having a concept in your mind of who you want in your church and who you don't want in your church. But he's talking about the assembly. Now, obviously, the word is synagogue. They were meeting in a synagogue. But it also has to do with whoever comes to church. Now, on our website, it says, currently meeting at, and it's, you know, what's that? 3729 West State Avenue, Phoenix, Arizona. Okay. Currently meeting it. You know, if we would ever be in a different building than our living room, I think I'm going to leave it there, currently meeting it. Because this isn't the church. It's the people is the church. It's not the building. This is my living room, you know? I mean, what I'm saying, I mean, it's currently meeting it is a better idea. Whoever is currently meeting, this is God's people currently meeting together. Yeah, it'd be nice to have a sanctuary and have all those kind of fun things that churches in America think are necessary to have, you know, the steeple and all the crosses and all the stained glass and all these things that basically have its origin from paganism, but we've called it Christian and everybody thinks it's Christian, you know. There's, you know, if you look at a Mormon temple and you look at a Christian church, the only difference that you see is there's no cross on the top of the pinnacle. They've kept everything from paganism and they kept the cross out so it didn't get sanctified. But it looks like a really nice, and it's got, you know, the nice, what do you call it? I forget the name of the architecture, but every one of them have the same kind of things, and colonial, whatever the colonial. It's like, wow, wouldn't that be a good church? Oh, it's a Mormon church. There's no cross on it. It's not the building. It's the people who have the Holy Spirit indwelling them who are on the inside. That's the church. The church is the assembly of believers, wherever it happens to be. In every other country, you wouldn't be looking for a church building like we would see on Christmas cards or on, you know, any of these, you know, American paintings or all that stuff. You know, it's very romantic, and it's very, oh, to see this old church in the country with the snow on it and all that, and you have a little thing with the Jesus family thing out there in front, what they're called. Nativity out there, right? Isn't that great, you know? But you go anywhere else in this world, that's not what churches look like. So then we're going to take our church culture and build them a building that looks just like that. They're not going to be able to relate to it. It's going to be just like what happened when Catholicism moved from country to country to country. Didn't mean that people got saved, but they got this Western culture of Christendom implanted in their culture. And that's what they look like. That's what they look at. And so all these people think they're Christians now. But they've got this thing implanted in their culture. But do they have a real relationship with the living God? If they have a real relationship with the living God, their life's been changed. And it doesn't matter what building they're in. Doesn't matter if it's a mud hut. Doesn't matter if it's a big, huge tree that people come underneath that tree to get out of to get in the shade, out of the hot sun, so they can hear somebody teach them. When we were in Honduras, the churches were basically a tin roof until more money came or something could happen and they could put sides on it. But our team had to get out of the rain, and there was more people of our team than were members of the church who were there. And the members of the church, they were willing to stand out in the rain to let our team stay underneath. And it's like, here's these old ladies and stuff, and they'd rather get rained on than to have the North Americans stand out in the rain. Well, that was church. This these beams that are holding up this tin roof, that's church. Now, why am I saying that? Because we get these weird concepts of Christianity. We get these weird concepts of church. No, it's God's believers who are currently meeting at this place, this tin roof, this ball bearing factory, this strip mall, this this cave, you know, this big tree in the jungle someplace. And he says, okay, you know, when people come to your assembly, your meeting, don't have prejudice against them. If they're coming to your assembly, a man with a gold ring and goodly apparel. Now, the Greek basically says he's got fingers full of gold. I mean, it's not like, oh, he's got a wedding ring on. No, he's got like ring. I mean, if there's another place to put a ring, it's on there. And he shows up, and he's got all these rings, and he's got goodly apparel. I mean, he's dressed nice. And there come also a poor man in vile raiment. Well, vile means dirty. Somebody coming in off the street, he's got dirty clothes. Why does he got dirty clothes? Well, because he doesn't have the money or the opportunity to get his clothes clean. If you're a homeless person, it's very difficult to live in clean clothes because you're going to sleep in the dirt. And where are you going to go to get your clothes clean? How are you going to get your clothes clean? If you're cleaning your clothes, is there a place that you can put your stuff so it doesn't get stolen? I mean, most of the time people are washing with their clothes on. That's how their clothes get clean. So here you are, folks in church. You got some nice looking folks, and they got it going on. And then you got somebody who comes in and they're dirty. And he says, and ye have respect to him that weareth the gay clothing. This guy's looking really good. And you're going to go, oh, we're so happy to have you in our church this morning. I'm glad you chose us this morning to our church to worship. When you could have gone anywhere. And all those things that you hear. And he says, sit thou here in a good place. Why? We want everybody to see you. I remember last church you went to, there'd be different visitors who come that were either councilmen or we had a representative, and you know, they wanted to make sure that everybody saw this part, or somebody who happened to be an American Idol. They made sure that they had this person having lots of prominence. They want everybody to know this is the kind of people who go to our church. I mean, they're on American Idol, or they've got this nice position, or you know, they're a senator, or you know, they even had the guy from Chick-fil-A speak in the pulpit. It's like, oh man. Anyway, all that to say, they're going to give him prominence, and they say to the poor, that poor person, the person that just came off in the street, what is that person in? They need Jesus. But what are they going to get? Stand over there. Or, sit here under my footstool. Now that sounds kind of weird. What does it mean to fit under your... Are people sitting there in a lounge chair and you got a crotch underneath somebody's lazy boy or something? No, basically, in a synagogue, there were seats of prominence. And there were also seats that were farther away. And when you're sitting, it's not like what we have in most churches where you've got pews in rows or you've got chairs set up in rows. You've got people with their stuff and their entourage, and then you've got people who are sitting next to them or near them. And so you could actually have somebody who is sitting where you're actually in a seat. They're going to sit on the floor by your feet. So somebody who is, you know, just came off the streets, you're not going to put them in a chair. They can sit on the floor. So stand there or sit here under my footstool. Well, under my footstool is also the idea of I'm in charge of you. I'm better than you are. I am the one who is in charge of your life and your death. So it had that phrase has more to do with just sitting on the floor. It has to do with if you're going to come to our church, you're going to have to do what we say. You can come here, but you have to. We're going to tell you where you can sit. We're going to. You know, you have to be completely under our authority. And when you see that in the Mormon Church, they'll take in the homeless. They'll be really kind to folks. They'll give people jobs and all kinds of stuff. They will do all kinds of stuff as long as you are under their authority and you are going to do everything to the letter. If you mess up, you're out. Back out on the street. I know that from people who I've talked to. This is reality. Well, I'm not saying all those bad Mormons. As long as you are doing by, you know, what they're telling you, they're going to take care of you. Well, that's not just the Mormons. A lot of churches like to have people as their slaves who are just in off the street, who are struggling in some sin. They are living in a state of shame, and the churches take full advantage of the shame that these people are living in and keep them under their feet. They keep them under control, and now those people will do anything. You can make them as the church. You can make them as, you know, security guards in a parking lot. You can make them be like a security guard or a bouncer at the church door. You can make them like a bodyguard for the pastor, and they never get set free. They are kept in that state of bondage, and now they aren't just under bondage to Satan, they're under bondage to the senior pastor. And I've watched it, and it's sick. And these people, some of them, they'll get positions. All of a sudden, in 6 months, they got saved, and now they are a deacon. Like, there's these people who have been working really hard and doing all this stuff, and here's a guy I've never seen before, and now he's a deacon? Yeah, because He's gonna submit. He's surrendered. He's got a new bondage. He's got a new boss.
But the new boss is just like the old boss. Just different.
No, I'm ashamed of Christians who do this, but this is what's going on.
This is what's going on. It's as though it's slavery. James is saying, no, this is sin. This is sin. This is absolutely sin.
But there's a lot of people, they're so happy to get somebody who is struggling in sin. Who they need the pastor to be their mommy who's going to change their dirty diaper. They need to hear from a pastor who's close to God. Yeah, Jesus died on the cross. He took your sins away. And they go, oh, I'm not going to go to hell, even though I deserve it. I love Jesus. And I'm going to do whatever my pastor tells me to do because I'm addicted to the next time him telling me I'm going to go to heaven. And they're kept under bondage. The bondage of the gospel is being used as chains. Where they should be set free once and for all. Where there's a point of growing up where you don't need a pastor to tell you you're not going to go to hell anymore because Jesus died on the cross for that sin. There's a place where we got to grow up from being a baby. It's like, oh no, I've sinned. I need my diaper changed to... I can change my own diaper. I can read it from the Word. It's the blood of Jesus that cleansed me from all my sin. When He is faithful and just to forgive me of my sin and cleanse me of all unrighteousness. We have to get from that point to that point. There's a point where I need to know from somebody with Jesus, with skin on, that Jesus forgave me and I'm going to go to heaven now. But there's another point where I grow up and I can read it for myself and I believe myself. But if people are kept into bondage, then they are going to do anything because they are desperate for the next time that pastor gives them absolution. And there's whole denominations that are based on, I am a called servant of the Word. Now proclaim the grace of God unto you. And until you hear that, you don't know for sure if God likes you anymore because you're a sinner. You don't know for sure that God forgave you until you hear that pastor give you absolution. That is not what the gospel's for. It's not a means to control humanity. Amen. It's a means for every single person to be set free. And to have my hand put in the hands of Jesus. Not my hand put in the hand of some senior pastor who's going to tell me about Jesus. No, I need my hand in Jesus' hand. That's what we need to do. And there's a lot of people who accumulate slaves, spiritual slaves. And they will say what they know that person wants to hear because now they're like addicted to this person. And this person can have a really good heart and they're going to a nice heart of exhortation and they're going to say all these good things and tell them how to live their life. And they don't have their own relationship there. They're connected and addicted to a human being. That human being needs to take their hand and put them in Jesus' hand where it belongs and not to say, okay, I'll tell you what Jesus says. No, we have one high priest, Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ once and for all died on the cross, once and for all poured out his blood for the sins of mankind. There are no grandchildren with God. They're all children of God. There is nobody. I don't need a priest. I got Jesus Christ. And it doesn't matter if you're a Catholic or if you're Episcopal or if you're a Protestant. There are as many of these priests who are taking Jesus' place in every bit of the church. So I know I kind of camped on this footstool thing a bit, but that bothers me a lot. Now I come from a denomination where the pastor's job, yeah, it wasn't Catholicism, but it was still, you have to wait for the pastor who is a called servant of the Lord to proclaim the grace of God upon you. And until you do that, you don't know if absolution has occurred or not. But if you look in the liturgy, it says right there, absolution. And that's what he says it. And you got to wait for that part of the service to get it out of the liturgy. I know I'm kind of pushing it to the limit. But this is how it feels. When you're the sinner and you need forgiveness. And you got to wait for the pastor to give it to you. I've been there. I used to think that when I was there at the communion rail and the pastor is going there and he gives you the bread and then he comes back and he gives you the cup and if you happen to be that person as he is there giving you the cup and you're the one who receives it right when he says those words given for you for the remission of sins, then you know you got it and Jesus took your sins away.
And I just would be praying to be that person. And I would be that person. And my day was great. And I just know that God loved me. And I knew my sins were forgiven. I knew I was okay with God. And I knew I was going to go to heaven. And I was afraid of tomorrow. Because I knew I was going to sin by tomorrow. God hadn't made anybody to put... He doesn't want anybody under anybody's footstool. No, Jesus' blood is the one that washes our sins away. Not somebody telling me that Jesus' blood washes my sins away. I know I made a big point of this, but this is a part of my life, and I just have to tell you my testimony. But I've watched it in church after church. People who were spiritual hotshots. They were like spiritual superstars. And they would have this entourage of people who felt like losers, who were just addicted to hearing this next piece of comfort from them. And these people, I mean, a lot of them were ladies. And they were good talkers. And they always had somebody listening to them because they were just, they had to hear from God from them. Well, they didn't do a good enough job. They should have shut up and led them to God's Word and let that person read it for themselves and hear from the Holy Spirit themselves. Because they got people addicted to them. Why could they get them addicted to them? Because they didn't show up with a good ring, looking good, looking like a spiritual hotshot themselves. They showed up in dirty clothes. So you show up in dirty clothes. And now there's these spiritual predators out there who are going to take you for their own. James says that's sin. Holy Spirit tells us that's sin. Now, I know I've kind of spiritualized this, but the biggest point is just looking at people from the outside. What's going on the inside? Somebody who looks good and they got lots of money and they show up and they got lots of money. Hey, let's let everybody know that you're here and we're all going to respect you and everything's going to be great. And this person who nobody knows, and he probably doesn't smell good, stand over there. And I watched that happen. They'd be ushered into the back rows. Now, before that was happening, when they were ushering in the back rows, there was a whole group of bikers that really liked this man's teaching. Because they heard about Jesus at their level. He was teaching the Bible. And they heard about Jesus at their level. And they showed up. And they were getting saved, and more bikers were getting saved. Now, bikers got, they're pretty self-absorbed people, and they got lots of problems, but they are hearing from Jesus, and they got saved. Somewhere that changed. Somewhere that church that was, I mean, one of the elders' wives was known for just hugging and kissing the biker and saying, you know, Jesus loves you and God bless you today. Something changed in that church. And one of the bikers who had stuck around, who was made a deacon, wasn't invited anymore to the deacon's outings. Because you just can't get all that biker stuff off of you, I guess. The church grew away from that. Now how does God see this man? He shows up at old folks' homes and does church. And they wheel these people in from the hospital and they see Jesus through this man. They listen to him. And there's some old Okie who's playing the guitar. And these people who can't communicate are singing songs that they sang as child and they are worshiping God even though their minds are no longer there. But the Holy Spirit that's on the inside from the time they got saved is worshiping God because they're born again. And they're hearing God's word from this man. Now I guarantee you take these two people at the judgment seat of Christ and who's going to get the reward? The one who is making a big thing of the people who with the gold rings and the nice apparel who, you know, are famous people, or the one who's going to people who nobody even cares about anymore. So that he's going to know that they're going to have basic instructions before leaving earth And they're going to get taken care of when even their families don't come to say hi to them anymore. No, there's a whole lot of sin. Same way as there was a whole lot of sin back then, there's a whole lot of sin going on in the church right now. I mean, this is heartbreaking stuff. There's a way to take care of God's people, and there's a way not to take care of God's people. And these words for us are just right on for what's going on. Now it's all seeker sensitive. Now it's all you don't want to offend anybody, and you want to make sure everybody has a good time in church, and you go to church and it doesn't even feel like church, so you want to come back. It's no longer getting people to hear God's word so that they're going to be convicted by the Holy Spirit. They're going to receive what Jesus did on the cross for them for the forgiveness of their sins, and they're going to go to heaven. Now it's about getting people to keep coming in large numbers to help support. Don't offend anybody, because they might stop sending money in. Verse 4. Are ye not then partial in yourselves and are become judges of evil thoughts? James is saying, if this is what you're doing, you are hypocrites. You are prejudiced. And he says, you are judges of evil thoughts. Which means you are judging, and you don't even know what you're judging. You think because a person might be dirty and smelling bad that he's got more sin in his life than the guy who's dressed good and smells good and he's got gold rings on his fingers? That's prejudice. You've got a preconceived notion of who God likes and who God doesn't like. But it's also judges with evil thoughts. Judges who are the ones who have the evil thoughts. You see somebody who's got it all together and they got the nice car and they got the nice clothes and you want them to be a part of your fellowship, your assembly, because it's going to make you look good. And somebody who doesn't look so good, that doesn't smell so good, you don't want them, because there's just so much work. We want the guys who are already done. We want the guys who can just show up and you can just give them a position and they'll start giving and they'll start serving. We don't want to have to spend a whole bunch of time, you know. I mean, you got to work a lot with these guys. I mean, if the reason why they don't have a job is because they're unemployable. I mean, you know how much work you got to do with somebody who's unemployable? Who's got the evil thoughts? The judges have the evil thoughts. And they're judging other people's lives. Now that person who's looking good and got the nice car and got the nice clothes and got the gold rings, he could be a whole lot worse of a sinner than the guy who shows up off the street, who lost his job and couldn't pay for his rent. Verse 5, hearken my beloved brethren, hath not God chosen the poor of this world, rich in faith, and heirs of the kingdom which he hath promised to them that love him? James is saying, open up your eyes to the way God sees it. How has God done it? He says, okay, hasn't God chosen the poor of this world to be rich in faith and heirs of the kingdom? Now, is there some kind of special thing that you have because you're poor? Like you're more righteous than somebody who's rich? No. But as what we've taught through before, when we have an abundance of things, there is also an abundant likelihood that we're going to be living independently from God. When we don't have an abundance of things and we don't have what we need, the likelihood is we are going to be desperate for God. And my experience is I've seen greater faith in poor people than in rich people. Unless those poor people want to be rich. And then you've got a very bitter Christian who's not really good for anybody
because God isn't giving them what they want, and they're discontented, and they really have a bad witness. I've seen both. I mean, we've all met people like this. But I have met people who have this amazing strong faith with God. Very strong. And their strong faith is based on the fact that they are trusting God for tomorrow's meal. They're trusting God for their place to sleep. A friend of mine was... you met him. He was homeless one time for 6 months. I mean, he wouldn't sleep outside at night, especially in the wintertime. He would sleep during the day someplace, like in parks during the day. But at night, he would be up all night, like at a Walmart, just looking at stuff. Because you could stay warm inside of a Walmart and just shopping. And then during the day, you could find some place to sleep. Nobody bothered you during the day because everybody's working. And God took care of him. God showed him where the food was. I mean, he learned that, you know, food is thrown away, how fast you need to eat it before it goes bad, and all those kinds of things. You learn that living on the streets. For as much as he's had lots of knocks in life, lots of problems, and a lot of them were his own problems and the consequences of that, he's got a very strong faith in the Lord. He's talking to God, and God's talking to him all the time. He's desperate for God. God hath chosen the poor of this world rich in faith. And we told you about when we were in Honduras, and these folks who were basically, if they had a house, it didn't have windows or doors. It didn't even have pavement on the floor. And they were trusting a good God to give them food for the next day. They had had year after year of just knowing that there is a good God and he's going to meet their needs. And when an opportunity would show up, they would go. I mean, this big flatbed truck would show up, and everybody would get on because somebody needed some people to work in a field somewhere. And they'd be gone for a week or 2 weeks or whatever, and they'd come back and be able to support their family. And they just had to trust whoever was there that was left in the community to take care of their kids. I mean, they were trusting a good God, and they didn't know him. And we showed up, and we gave them the gospel, and they met Jesus Christ. They got saved right away because they already trusted a good God. And they had nothing. And yeah, we gave the kids candy and we gave them clothes and stuff like that. But we didn't buy their faith. Hath not God chosen the poor of this world rich in faith and heirs of the kingdom which he had promised to them that love him? Now, being poor in the things of this world doesn't mean that you're saved. Because as I share my faith, I remember talking to this one lady who was sure she was going to go to heaven because this life that she was living was hell. So she deserved something good because she had such a bad life. And, you know, they look at the parable that Jesus gives of the rich man and poor Lazarus. And, you know, the rich man, he goes to hell because he had such a good life here, and the poor man, because he didn't have anything, he deserves heaven because he had such a... No, it's not you go to heaven because you're poor. No, you go to heaven because you place your faith in Jesus Christ. That's why you go to heaven. It's not determined on what you own and what you don't own. I just have to make that point. But Jesus says in the Sermon on the Mount, I'll just read it real quick, Matthew 5. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are they that do hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Blessed are the poor in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. Blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are ye when men shall revile you and persecute you, and say all manner of evil against you falsely for my name's sake. Rejoice and be exceedingly glad, for great is your reward in heaven, for so they persecuted the prophets which were before you. In these Beatitudes, the beginning of the Sermon on the Mount, he's got all these blesseds. Well, every one of those doesn't make sense, because it's not the way the world works. The poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. The meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Well, that doesn't make any sense. It does in God's kingdom. Why? Because those people who are poor, who are trusting a good God, are rich. Because their hand is in the hand of the one who owns everything, who's in control of everything, who's sitting on the throne of heaven. The meek are the ones who aren't taking every advantage they can, who aren't stepping on everybody else, who aren't, you know, competing at everything to be the winner. No, the meek are the ones who are letting everybody do their thing, and they're just going to trust God to take care of them. It's not a passive life. It's people who are fully capable of hurting others and stepping on others to get to the top, but are trusting God instead. It says, God hath chosen the poor of this world, rich in faith, and heirs of the kingdom which he has promised them that love him. There's a lot of promises to people who love God. All things work together for good to those that love him or are called according to his purpose. A lot of people want all things to work out together for their good. But do they love God? I mean, that's a great promise, but it doesn't apply to everybody. It only applies to people who love God. And a lot of people don't love God because God hasn't given them a good enough life. There's all kinds of expectations for their life that God hasn't met, so they don't love God. Well, all things are not working out together for their good. It's not working out at all. And it won't until they repent. Until they repent of their pride and they surrender to Jesus Christ. But the moment they do that, they're going to be rich in faith and heirs of the kingdom that he has promised them that love them. It's not work righteousness. It's not poor righteousness, working yourself poor so that you can gain righteousness. And of course, a lot of this stuff we're confused with because there's people, you know, like Mother Teresa and her vow of poverty and all that stuff. And it's like, and she did all these great things for the poor, and people think that's how to be righteous before God. And so people get confused with these passages. Well, that's asceticism. And we talked a lot about asceticism when we were in the book of 1 John. Because it's a Gnostic idea. As though there's something you can do to somehow get yourself closer to God. Well, the only thing we can get to get closer to God is to say, Lord, what you did on the cross, you did for me. And you took my sins away. It's about as close as we can get. The only thing I brought to God in my relationship with him is my sin. And he took it away on the cross. That's all I brought to this relationship. I had nothing going for me except my sin. That's what it means to be a Christian. That's what it means to surrender to Jesus Christ. But God hath chosen the poor of this world, rich in faith, and heirs the kingdom that he has promised to them that love him. Now James is saying that because his first audience is going to know the scriptures that say that. And he's quoting from Proverbs and Psalms that basically say the same thing. As we've been studying through the Psalms, David is crying out to God. And he is holding on to promises like this as he is comforting himself in the Lord. So then James says, but ye have despised the poor. You just look at a poor person and despise them. Right away you got a prejudice against them because they're poor. Now, there was some preconceived problems that they had in their theology. If you remember, when Jesus was there with his disciples in the temple, and Jesus takes all the attention of all of his disciples and says, look at that old lady up there. Look what she's going to do. And they're watching, and she just puts what would be to us a half a penny. Two small little coins. And she dropped it in this bowl for the collection. And they had seen all these rich people pouring riches into this thing. And Jesus said, that lady put everything in there. That's all she had. Everybody else just gave of their abundance. Jesus didn't stop her from doing it. But Jesus said, if you just look at the percentages, she gave 100%, and these guys maybe gave 1%. They gave over the top of whatever they had. Even if they gave 10, even if they gave 50%, they are still so filthy rich, 50% didn't mean anything. But this lady, she gave what to this world would say, what would be the point of her even doing that? You can't even do anything with that amount of money. But Jesus said she gave everything. The world sees it from the outside. Jesus sees it from the inside. And whenever I bring up that story, I have to address megachurch pastors and ask them, what are you going to do with the widow's mite? Because Jesus is going to hold you accountable for that. Because they just gave everything in your collection plate. How are you going to use it to my glory? And you get these guys on the radio and these guys on TV. And they're saying all these crazy things. Oh, if you give this money, you're going to get 100% return. And you got poor people who are sending them money because it's like gambling. It's like spiritual gambling. They're going to put it in and maybe they're right. And I want to get my 100% return. And they're stealing money from God's people. Show me the passage that they can get that out of. It's not there. Jesus didn't teach it. No, they're stealing people's money. And they're doing it with a false promise that they're going to get something back. And so all these people who have just been throwing all this money, good after bad, to all these bad evangelists out there, they're just waiting for God to give them back. Just any moment, God's going to pour all this abundance in my lap, and it keeps not happening, and it keeps not happening, it keeps not happening, because they are holding on to a false expectation. It's not the truth. And they're so afraid not to believe, because if they doubt it, then it won't happen. And it's their own fault because of their lack of faith, and they don't get it. It's a lie. And somebody just picked your pocket. There was this assumption that because somebody was rich, that God was blessing them, as though they had God's approval. We went through the book of Job, and it was proved through the book of Job that is false. That's not the way it works. And that came up to Jesus with his disciples. It's not the abundance that a person has. That doesn't prove anything. But that's the way the world looks at it. So we see somebody with all this riches. Oh, he's a member of our church. Isn't that great? And we think about all the ministries we can now do. And now all the money we can now send out. And all these things that can now happen. Because we got this guy who's got all this money. And he's going to just... We can buy a bigger building. And we can all fly first class. Now, how is Jesus going to get the glory through all that? Jesus doesn't get the glory for any of that. People do. People think because they're rich, somehow God loves them better than somebody who's poor. No, we met people who God really loves, and they're poor. And God kept them poor, and they know God.
Because there's nothing getting in the way of their relationship with God. There's no possessions. There's no money in the bank. There's nothing that they can hold on to getting in the way of their own personal relationship with God. They're desperate for God every single day. And he says, but you despise the poor. These are the people who really know Jesus because they are desperate for him and they're talking to him all the time. And he says, do not the rich oppress you and draw you before the judgment seats? Do they not blaspheme that worthy name by which ye are called? It's like, look at the reality of rich people. How are they rich? How did they get rich? They got rich by taking advantage of poor people. That's how come they're rich now. They didn't get rich because God loved them so much that he gave them a whole bunch of stuff. No, they got rich by stepping on people like you, and you know that to be the fact because you've already been taken advantage of by them. They're going to court. They're suing everybody they can to get something for nothing that they didn't want to work for, but they know they can take advantage of somebody who's poor because they've got no political power. They've got nobody who's going to protect them before a law court, and they can do whatever they want. Now, I've never worked for a Christian. Never have. I only work for folks who, unless they repent, they're going to go to hell. I don't know what it's like. I've talked to a lot of folks who've worked for Christians. And you got to wonder. The way they treat their employees. The way they take advantage of their employees. The way they keep their employees without benefits working for low wages. And even megachurches who are hire people and they say, oh, it's a ministry. Well, if it's a ministry, then let me send out a letter to everybody in your congregation to ask for support for me and my family then. How dare you? Got a lot to answer for. And if you're a Christian and you're taking advantage of people, especially because you're a Christian brother or sister, and you're going to let them live and just eking along another day of survival because you're going to give them low wages and refuse to give them benefits, you got a lot to answer for before a holy God. You're going to get your benefits for you and your family, but the people who are doing your work for you, you're refusing to give them that? Well, if you're a Christian, you got a lot to answer for. But that's how you stay rich. You don't give it away. You keep it. You invest it. And that's what James is saying. Why do you think somebody rich coming into your church is such a good thing? Now, he makes a prejudice statement about rich people. He doesn't necessarily make a statement about the rich who are Christians. But he's talking about the rich who are the ones who are suing you because they can. I can't afford a lawyer. Somebody could sue me and take everything and I'll have to go bankrupt because I won't be able to do anything. You know what I'm saying? Because I'm not rich. I mean, that's what's happening right now. Go through, look at every single Christian, I mean, an overtly Christian company and what's happening to them. They are being sued by the non-Christians. I mean, you know, the biggest, you know, with Obamacare, that's a big, you know, and so they're trying to destroy Hobby Lobby and Chick-fil-A and everybody else. Chick-fil-A kind of snuck in and they got something that they didn't have to pay right away until they got this thing in whatever it is, not litigation, but whatever, in litigation. So while that's going on, they don't have to pay. But not Hobby Lobby. No, they showed up and they shut them down and they don't pay and they're going to go out of business. They will, because they won't be able to pay. They're going to be fined so much money, they're going to go down. And the world wins again. And the world will win because the world leader is called the Antichrist. And he's going to kill every single Christian. You know, as you study through in the book of Revelation, starting in chapter 6, and you go through everything that the Antichrist is going to be allowed to do, he's going to be allowed to kill every single Christian. I don't think any Christian's going to survive the tribulation. There's none left. He kills them all. Yeah, but what about the 144,000? What about the third of the Jews? This is the time of Jacob's trouble. It's not the time of the church. Whole different dispensation here. God is
having a special thing with his people in those 7 years. Yeah, there's 144,000, and yeah, there's a third of the Jews that don't get killed, but the Antichrist is allowed to kill two-thirds of the Jews. It's going to be worse than any Holocaust we've ever seen so far. And there is no evidence that any single Christian survives the tribulation. They're all beheaded by the Antichrist, because God allows it. And when Jesus shows up, he has full reign to destroy with the breath of his mouth every bit of the Antichrist forces, and they're all dead. And then he's going to take his throne and rule from Jerusalem over the Jews, his people, just like it says. And he's going to make sure everything is done the right way. And there's going to be justice. And the bad people will pay. They're going to pay with their life and an eternity in the lake of fire. Jesus is going to show up. Now, right now, God is not doing that so quickly. And it seems like God isn't just by allowing bad things to happen. But what we don't see is the patience of God, who doesn't want people to go to hell, but he's giving them another day to repent, and giving them another day to repent. We're saying, Lord, why don't you just kill them, and they won't be able to hurt people anymore. And he's saying, nope, there's another day. There's going to be a time when it's over, and I show up, and it's over. And they won't have a prayer, because it's too late for the sinner's prayer. Well, James tells us, but you have despised the poor. And he says, do not the rich oppress you and draw you before the judgment seats? Do not they blaspheme that worthy name by which ye are called? It's like, don't think that the rich are so great. It's not some virtue to be rich. Now, these word of faithers, these name and claim it folks, they'll tell you that it's somehow a shame to be poor. They will say that, like you are somehow offensive to God if you're poor. It's like, haven't they read this? They have so twisted scripture so that people are willing to hand over their hard-earned money to these characters for just hope upon hope that God's going to give them that 100% return. Well, Jesus did promise that whatever we lose for the sake of the kingdom of Jesus Christ, we will get that back. But when he said that, he said, and persecutions. That word, and persecutions, is all part of that. Yeah, we'll get it back, but it's going to come back with persecution. He's going to give us what we need, and what we need to endure persecution. There's a lot of dominionist theology out there that it's about reclaiming this world for God. And then when we get this thing perfect, then Jesus will show up. And they're talking about revival, and they got it all wrong. Why don't you read the book? Read the Bible. No, the Antichrist takes over, and the Christians are killed. Read it. That's what Jesus said. No, there isn't some gigantic revival that's going to happen, and then we're going to make this place wonderful, and then Jesus is going to get here. No, this whole place goes down to toilet, and Jesus shows up, and he kills all his enemies with the breath of his mouth. He's got a different plan for the church. The church is not there to rule the world. Jesus rules the world. After he has poured out his wrath on a Christ-rejecting world, then he shows up. Once he has put all enemies under his feet, then he shows up. Read Psalm 2. That's what happens. But we get this weird idea that, oh, rich means other rich means other rich, and then more rich, and then all these nice rich people come. And we'll have this great rich church. Well, why don't you just go over to like Silicon Valley where all rich people are? And why not just do a diagnostic survey over the whole community and find out what they think a church should look like and what kind of programs that church should do? And then build that. And if you build it, they will come. And you could call it Saddleback.
Won't that be special? And you can have the richest church. And you can write a book called Purpose Driven Life and make millions of dollars. And then all the money that you make from that church, from that book, you can just give back to the church as your past wages. Oh, I'm so humble that I'm giving back all the money I made from this book that I've sold to all these Christians to pay for my back wages. And everybody knows it. Oh, isn't he a humble guy? No, he wants a rich church full of rich people, and he's not going to offend them. This is completely opposite to what James is saying here. You don't give the rich what they want so that they give you what they've got and then they go to hell for an eternity. No, you show up and you give them the Word of God, and if they like it, great. And if they don't, too bad. You are a proclaimer of the Word of God, and you got to stand before God and you got to answer for what you say. And if it hurts some people's feelings, if it offends some people, it ain't you that's doing it, it's Jesus. And he's been offending people for years because he calls everybody a sinner and he calls everybody to repentance. And if you're going to bring a rich person into your church just because he's rich and you're not going to call him to repentance, you got a lot to answer for. And if you do that and you let him get away with stuff, then everybody else in church is going to get away with that stuff. And that is what happens in all these mega churches. So you got this big church up here, Radiant or whatever, and one of their senior pastor, he got caught. I mean, it's in the news. And he told this man to divorce his wife and told the wife to divorce the man because he was asking her to have sex with him. And now, give me a break. This is not Christianity here. It's about people getting what they want from the people in church. As a pastor, you are there. As a parent, to take care of whoever God brings. You're not there as some master of ceremonies, everybody comes to hear you. No, you are there for them. And however many people God brings you, God is going to hold you accountable for each one. That's why James says in chapter 3, "My brethren, be not many masters." Don't if you want to be a teacher, knowing that ye shall receive the greater condemnation. And they think because they got this big, rich church that God is blessing their ministry. No, they've got this big condemnation coming. It's not a commendation from God because they got rich people in their church. It's a greater condemnation when they stand before the judgment seat of Christ. Because they wanted rich people, because they want the riches. And he says, no, what are these rich people doing? They're blaspheming the worthy name by which ye are called. Blaspheming the name of Jesus. How could they blaspheme the name of Jesus? What does that mean? That means that they don't need Jesus. The people who I've worked for, who were very proud of the fact that they had at least $1 million, they were happy to be rich. And they were happy to not have any need. They were happy to be in that small, one, like, 0.5% of all humanity. They're really happy to be there. Because they have no needs. And they don't need Jesus. They got good health care. They got good drugs. They got a good house. They got a good car. And they're going to take advantage of anybody who works for them so that they don't lose another nickel that they don't have to lose. They're blaspheming the name of Jesus because they don't want Jesus. They're good enough. One boss I had, if you asked him, how are you? He'd go, perfect. He would say, perfect. Just to get everybody crazy, he'd always say, perfect. Well, I kept his business running for him for 1.5 years while he was suffering through depression. But still, if you asked him during his deep depression, he would still say, perfect. We actually made a 5% greater profit that year because I was in charge. And I was hiring Christians. I mean, it was like I was building a business off after myself. Well, then he pulled out of depression, and then he took over, and he just wrecked everything and fired me. But all I have to say, we had a really good thing. We had a great team. Everybody was helping each other. It was, if there was any kind of problem, it wasn't like everybody pouncing on him and killing him and, you know, it's like, it's your fault, you know. No, everybody got together and fixed the problems. It was great running this business for 1.5 years, but all I have to say. He was perfect. He didn't need me. He was perfect. He doesn't need Jesus. He's perfect. He ain't going to go to heaven unless he repents.
I don't know where he's at with the Lord now. Now that's how come they blaspheme the worthy name by which you're called. It's blasphemy to say I'm not a sinner. It's blasphemy to say I'm perfect. It's blasphemy to say I'm basically a good guy and I never met a man I didn't like. Everybody's basically good. Brotherhood, you know, brotherhood of man. Whatever. It's blasphemy. No, I need a Savior. I don't care how much money I'll ever make, I still need a Savior. And if God's going to keep me poor so that I know I need a Savior, I'd rather be poor. Because every day I know I need a Savior. And the day I don't think I need a Savior is the day I got a big problem. I'm going to stand in blasphemy against my Savior. No, I need a Savior. Every day I need a Savior. I don't want so much stuff that I'm going to forget about God. I want to read that real quick. In Proverbs 31, I think. Right there in the beginning. Or is it? Maybe it isn't 31. Okay, let's see. You know, I think you know what I'm thinking is, you know, don't give me so many riches that I forget God, or so poor that I steal and disgrace that. I thought it was 31. Oh well, I'm sorry. I thought I'd go right to it. Oh, it's 30. Okay. Two things I have required of thee. Deny me them not before I die. Remove far from me the vanity of lies. Give me neither poverty nor riches. Feed me with food convenient for me, lest I be full and deny thee, and say, who is the Lord? Or lest I be poor and steal, and take the name of my God in vain. Yeah, these are the words of Agar. That's it. The words of Agar. Yeah. These are words of wisdom from God. The man who wrote this, inspired by the Holy Spirit, was giving us what we need to live life. It's so easy to walk away from God. All we got to do is have it good. Verse 8, if ye fulfill the royal law according to the scripture, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself, ye do well. But if ye have respect to persons, ye commit sins, and are convinced of the law as transgressors. So he's saying, having this partiality for the rich over the poor is sin. He says it really, you commit sin. Now, it says respect of persons, but the idea is, by outward appearance, having more respect for one person than another person. And so it is having partiality, being prejudiced. And he says, you are convinced or convicted of the law as transgressors. And so the law is actually telling you, the Holy Spirit is telling you, I'm convicting you of the sin. You stand guilty before the law because this is sin. But he says, if ye fulfill the royal law according to the scriptures, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself, ye do well. James calls it the royal law. Now, I don't know why for sure he calls it the royal law. But a royal law would have to do with the kingdom. And the king. Well, Jesus is the king, and the kingdom of God is a kingdom. And so the royal law, the greatest law in the kingdom of God, in other words, is this: thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. And it's very simple. How do you want to be treated? That's how you treat others. How do you want to be spoken to? That's how you speak to others. How do you want people to communicate with you? That's the way you communicate with them. Now, a lot of people communicate different ways and take on information different ways. So you want people to communicate in a way that you can understand. And so sometimes it takes some learning. How to learn in what way I can communicate with a person. I'm not you know, it's hard for me to communicate with somebody who's 3 and 4 and 5. I mean, because I don't have little kids every day to communicate with. It's hard. Because I can just pass on by. I just kind of give up and just treat them like everybody else. I mean, you know, some people are really good with that age group. I just do my best. But I want them to know what I have to say. I want them to know that I like them. I want them to know that Jesus likes them. And if I've done that, I'm okay. Because I want people to... I want to know from people that they like me. And I want to know from people that Jesus likes me and loves me. So, doing the best I can. But, as a communicator, I know I can do better, you know? So, this is a law that it doesn't necessarily... My point is, it doesn't necessarily come natural. It takes some study of ourselves and humanity to understand how to love thy neighbor as thyself. And we grow in this. And for a man, he needs to have a doctorate degree in his wife. And a woman needs to have a doctorate degree of her husband, because we are called to that. And as a mommy, you need to have a doctorate degree for every single one of your kids. And as a daddy, you need a doctorate degree for every one of your kids. So, it's a process that we learn. But this fulfills the royal law, to treat others as you want to be treated. And he says, if you have partiality, respect for persons, you commit sin. As you do this, you're continuing to commit sin, as you continue to practice it. And you are convinced, you are convicted of the law as transgressors. And then he says, for whosoever shall keep the whole law and yet offend in one point, he is guilty of all. And that's a biggie. Well, he explains that sentence in verse 11, for he that said, do not commit adultery, said also, do not kill. Now if thou commit no adultery, yet thou kill, thou art become a transgressor of the law. So he's making sure you understand what verse 10 means. For whosoever shall keep the whole law and yet offend in one point, he is guilty of all. A good illustration is, do you have any other balloons? No? Ran out of balloons from yesterday? Okay. Well, if we had a balloon, you could write 1 to 10 on that balloon. And each one of those numbers would stand for one of the 10 commandments. Now take a pin and poke it through number 8. What happens? The whole balloon breaks. Or I could take a window and write 1 to 10 on the window. And I take a rock. Well, I'm going to throw a rock through number 3. Well, the whole window breaks. The idea is, you break one law, you've broken the entire fabric of the law. So, yeah, if you could say, okay, yeah, I didn't commit adultery. Yeah, I murdered, but I didn't commit adultery. No, you broke the law. So, I mean, he really takes an extreme, because murder and adultery are like the biggest, worstest kind of law-breaking things you can do. So he uses that as an illustration just to let us know that this is just as serious. Having prejudice against somebody, being partial against somebody who is wealthy over and above somebody who is poor, or misusing and mistreating somebody who is poor just because they're poor, is no different than any other biggie, like murder or adultery. They're just as bad. Verse 12, so speak ye and so do, as they that shall be judged by the law of liberty. And so he comes back to this other phrase, law of liberty, and I talked about law of liberty before. We obey Jesus' commands because we want to. Because we're saved, we have the ability to keep his commands. We have been set free by the words of Jesus. We have been set free from the condemnation of our sin. Because we have been set free, now we are able to do what is pleasing to God. Before we were saved, we couldn't please God. Before we were saved, we couldn't help but do what was displeasing to God. For as much as we thought we could do everything we wanted without a relationship with God, I just do because I don't consider anything a sin. We think we have liberty. But the truth is, we are under bondage to Satan and the world system. Where the law of liberty is, I know what's right and I know what's wrong, and I have the ability to do what's right because the Holy Spirit is inside of me, He gives me the willingness and the ability to do what is pleasing to Him. So it's by that law that we are going to be judged. So James is saying, you guys know better. And if you continue in it, the very law that has set you free is going to be your judge. So he's not soft-pedaling this at all. I mean, he's taking it all the way to the very edge, to the very end. Why? Because it's a serious thing. And it's very easy for us to judge people by what they look like. And it's a real thing living in this world. And we have to take a step back before we make a prejudice against anybody. Now, we just had MLK Day, and the speech that he gave, he said that he was hoping for that day when people wouldn't be judged according to their color, but by the content of their character. I'm glad she got the word better than I can remember. That's a real judgment, the content of a person's character. Well, the content of a person's character should be very obvious. And if we have been changed by God's Word, we've been changed by the Holy Spirit, people are going to see the content of our character. But if we are being blemished, so to speak, and we've been spotted by the world, nobody's going to know. And so a lot of people are saying, hey, people got prejudice against me. Well, why are you walking around as though you've been spotted by this world? I don't see any content of character. I see you just as evil and as such, as sinful and immoral as everything of this ugly world. Oh, they're just trying to be relevant to the culture. Well, that's not being relevant. You're spotted by the world. So all that to say, there are actual things, real virtues, by which we can be judged, by which we are held accountable and judgeable. And the only time when this is actually going to happen, when Martin Luther King's speech is going to reach its fulfillment, is when Jesus is sitting on the throne of his father David, when he's removed every enemy by killing them with the breath of his mouth. That's when that's going to happen. And it's unfortunately not going to happen until then. Some certain races may be able to have more rights than they used to. But this is the reality of ugliness of the human heart. James makes it clear. We as Christians should know better. We should know better. We should be proving this by how we interact with people. Now James isn't saying, well, don't have to, they'll just drop all your discernment. I mean, if somebody is going to be evil and ugly and a monster, you don't want them abusing your family or abusing you. But to just put that judgment upon them and expecting the worst because of how they look is sin. So, let's pray. Lord Jesus, we ask that you help us, Lord. Open up our eyes to the reality of the way things really are, dear God. Lord, we want to have mercy on the people who are in need. We want to be able to take care of them as you put them in our lives. And Lord, you also, we know from Proverbs that we aren't required to give what we don't have. And you don't ask us to give until it hurts. You never ask us to give what we don't have. So, Lord, in whatever way that you are giving us opportunity to help those who need help, Lord, put that in our hands to help them. Lord, it's very difficult in our culture who to help, and do they have a need, or are they just sitting there not wanting to work and holding a sign? Lord, we don't understand what's actually going on. So we need your discernment, dear God. But, Lord, as James is being very specific in the dealing with the church service where people are gathering together to hear from you and worship you, Lord, let that not be known of us as people who are prejudiced, who are going to have more respect for somebody because they got more money. Lord, help us see others with your eyes, dear God. In Jesus' name, amen.